interested in more of the emergency services and going, you know, out to the scene. And maybe they want to be a firefighter. Maybe they want to be EMS on the ambulance, you know, with ambulance service. So we just want to try to get you going in some direction and help you find something that you're interested in along the way. And it may help you find out what you're not interested in. So with that said, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Johnson, and he is going to go through graduation requirements first, so that you know what you must take, and then we'll get into the options of what you can take. And we'll talk about different things. We also have a representative, Sarah, I just met her tonight.
Sally,
from Wallace State Community College. And so if you have different questions about what's available as far as dual enrollment, Fast Track Academy, or different career tech dual enrollment programs that they have, she'll be able to answer some of those questions. There are scholarships available for students. I know going into, there's a lot of scholarships for career tech dual enrollment. So she can provide information about that as well. So if you think you're interested in a career tech program at Wallace, she'll be able to give you that scholarship information as well, and you can start that while you're in high school. Okay, and Mr. Johnson.
All right, first of all, this is just kind of an overview of what this presentation is going to look like. So to begin with, we'll talk about the graduation requirements. So everyone is required to have 4 years of math, science, English, and history. So that's 16 credits. We're also required to have 3 years of electives in the categories of fine arts, foreign language, or career tech. We also have 2.5 required electives that can be in any other category. And we also have to have a half credit of health and a full credit of EE. Am I leaving anything out? Okay, so that equals 24 credits. Well, and career prep. I did leave that out. We do have to have a year of career prep. Last year we applied for a waiver that embeds career prep B into our senior economics class. And so that should free up most of our high school students if they come to us with career prep A already, and they shouldn't have to take career prep the rest of the time that they're here. So this is the outline of physical education. I mentioned earlier we have to have 1 year of PE, but we can also meet that requirement by playing a sport or playing in the marching band. Are there any other? JROTC also makes that PE requirement. So these are all the things I've already talked about. So if you look at this 3 credits of fine arts, foreign language, or career tech, they could be all 3 from the same category. There could be any combination of those 3. But at least 3 electives from those 3 categories. Does that make sense? So you could take a sequence of foreign languages, so Spanish 1 and 2, German 1 and 2, French 1 and 2, and a fine art, or you could take 3 years of a career tech pathway. As long as you have 3 full credits of career tech, fine arts, or foreign language.
And if you have your registration card with you, if you'll look on the back of your registration card, those electives are categorized in those 3 categories across the top. So you should see your foreign languages, your fine arts, and then your career tech options that you can choose from. And then down at the bottom, there are some other various elective options. But if they don't fall under the heading of foreign language, fine arts, or career tech, if they have a different heading, it means they don't meet one of those requirements.
Mr. Johnson, so you don't specifically have a fine art now, like you used to have?
That's correct. You do not have to have a fine art. You could have 3 credits of career tech if you'd like. Any other questions? So this just gives some examples. These are some examples of the career tech classes we offer. Educator preparedness, or educator preparation and teacher education, that's a new program we just started this year. That's a good question. So you're asking, does it have to be on the same pathway?
No, like, I'm asking is
in sequence. Is that what you're saying? Yeah, like, does it have to be like dance 1, 2, and 3? No.
Okay, she's in marching band. Every year, marching band, that considered for that replacement?
Except for the year that it counts as their PE credit. Actually, if they're in marching band, that's a half credit in the fall of their freshman year, and then a half credit in the fall of their sophomore year. That makes one full credit. If they're using that as their PE credit,
okay,
they cannot also use that as a fine art credit.
Okay.
Right. But after that, that junior year fall, senior year fall would make a fine art credit. Or if they're doing marching band and then symphonic, their junior year, that's a full credit. And then marching band, symphonic, or concert, their senior year, that's a full credit. So a half, first semester makes a half credit, second semester makes a half credit to make that one full credit.
Okay.
So you could have a combination or a blend.
So the sophomore year doesn't give you half credit?
It gives you the marching band, first semester of freshman and sophomore year, gives you their full year of their PE credit.
That completes
okay.
the half of it.
And it cannot count as PE and final.
Okay.
But the marching is the only. The symphonic or concert just counts as
final. That's why she was saying that it would take
freshman. There's some things up here.
First semester and sophomore second. I'm sorry. Freshman first semester and sophomore first semester to get that full credit of PE. Does that make sense?
Okay.
Good question. So these are all the programs that we offer through the Coleman Area Career Center. So starting in 10th grade, students can attend the Coleman Area Career Center and pursue one of these areas of career tech. Most people don't start in 10th grade because we require health, and most people have to have that taken in the 10th grade. So most of the time, health is a half credit. Most of our students pair up health and driver's ed and take with 4 core. If you have another period that takes health and driver's ed, it only leaves you with 2 more periods. Well, all of these programs are blocked in 2 periods a day. So it limits what you can take here, especially in that sophomore year. A lot of people will complete a second year of foreign language. You know, we have a lot of students who participate in athletics, band, fine arts. So those kinds of things limit some of the options as far as going to the career centers. But that is available in 10th and 12th grade.
James?
Yes.
Driver's Ed offered in the summer?
It is at West Point. We don't offer it here, but a lot of our students will take it to West Point. So, and that's a good option as well. I think it takes maybe 2 weeks to complete that. So if student, is it 1 week? Okay, 1 week. So, I mean, if my child were interested in going to the Career Center as a sophomore, I would probably pursue that route to get that driver's ed credit and help you on your insurance, and then they would have to take a whole semester to get that credit. That's right. We could also, you know, if that were something they're interested in as well, they could take health. You know, we offer summer school here, so, you know, students could you go ahead and take that driver's ed and health credit over the summer and not have to worry about that. There's all going to be. For juniors and seniors, we have a work-based learning program where students are able to co-op up to 3 periods a day. Typically, 3 periods would be your seniors, but a lot of our juniors do 2 periods a day if they've met all their other elective requirements. So basically, students can go to work and leave school after 5th or 6th period, can go to work somewhere. They earn career tech credit for that time they spend away from school, so it's not like it's just wasted. Credits that they're missing or anything like that. So they do get career tech credit. We We actually have someone over this program that monitors very closely now, so it's a good program. I think it really gives students an idea of what it's like to be in the workforce and, you know, pursue a career path that they may be interested in. And like Ms. Hall said before, it may give them an idea of things they don't want to do. But the days of just leaving school, you know, like early dismissal or late arrival, that's over. You know, we really stress that if they're going to be off campus, they're going to have to be getting credit for that time away. So that's what this work-based learning is all about. These are the foreign languages we offer. We actually lost our German teacher at the end of last summer. So we were actually, it was 2 weeks before the school year was about to start. She got offered a job near her home in Huntsville, so we didn't have an opportunity to fill that position. Our students who were signed up for German had the option to opt out to take a different foreign language. But we do offer German through our access classes online. Probably not the ideal way to learn a foreign language, but it's the best we can do on short notice. We do have teachers for Spanish 22 and French 22 on campus, and there are also several other foreign languages that are offered through Access. There's a long list of courses from German to Mandarin, Chinese. I mean, there's several. What's that?
Latin
is available. So there's a whole list of classes available through Access if your child is interested in taking something other than these three. We can look at that if they'd like to meet and discuss those options individually. We offer several AP courses here. AP is a college preparatory program that the rigor that is required to do an AP course is much higher than a lot of college courses. And so I know some of your students may be taking pre-AP courses at this time. They may be in some AP courses at this time. So you all know what I'm talking about. We started pre-AP classes 5 years ago in an attempt to better prepare students to take AP courses their junior and senior years. So with that, they'll take AP courses in the areas of chemistry, we offer physics, biology, calculus, statistics, U.S. history, English language and composition, literature, psychology, computer science principles, art. So we have lots of AP options, and with that, at the end of the coursework, the students prepare for an exam. If they make a qualifying score on that exam, a 3, 4, or 5, they can earn college credit through that AP course. We also use our AP courses for dual enrollment credit through Wallace State Community College, which we'll get into a little bit more later on. So we have that as an option for students who may not be confident in putting all of their potential college credit in one test. So if they take the class through it, or take that AP class on our campus, but would like to get, you know, ensure college credit basically, then they can sign up through dual enrollment or through Wallace State for dual enrollment credit. And basically what that does is that just says, okay, I'm going to take this as a dual enrollment course. So I get high school credit and college credit through Wallace State, no matter what I make in the AP exam. This slide just kind of gives you more of a description of the things I just talked about. Any questions about AP? And one thing I did forget to mention, I just noticed that at the bottom of the slide. All pre-AP courses are weighted 5 points on students' GPAs. AP courses are weighted 10 points. So there is that incentive to take more rigorous curriculum. Obviously, you have the opportunity to earn college credit, but also we're going to reward those students for being willing to work at the higher level by giving them that, you know, incentive through the 10 extra points on their cumulative GPA. Bill and Roman, Ms. Burks, would you like to get into this a little bit?
Sure. Do y'all want me to go over all three things, or take one of the three?
Sure.
So we offer three different types of dual enrollment at Wallace State or Coleman City. The first one I'm going to talk about is career tech dual enrollment, just because that's probably one of the most that we offer a ton of programs. It's not an academic. That's what's in me. So I'll talk about it. To be in career tech dual enrollment, he went over some career tech classes. We have a list of what we cover on a scholarship basis. So if you come take career tech dual enrollment with us, we will pay for 6 hours, which means two classes, because most college courses are going to be 3-hour courses. So if you were to take an English 101 in high school, that's a credit. That's the same thing. You know, if you were to take it in college, that's what we call a 3-hour course. So with that being said, we'll pay for two of those classes. So in career tech, you come to school early. So, again, you have to work with them anyways. But, so you'll take your core classes here on campus, then you will come to Wallace and take those 6 hours that we're going to pay for. So you're half in high school and you're half in college. And the programs that we cover, there's a long list, so bear with me on this. We cover automotive body repair, air conditioning and refrigeration technology, agricultural production, automotive technology, automated manufacturing technology, computer science, computerized numerical control, diesel mechanics, emergency medical technology, engineering technology or engineering technician, health information technology, industrial electronics technology, medical assisting technology, medical laboratory technician, machine tool technology, office administration, pharmacy technician assistant, paralegal or legal assistant, welding, and child development. So I know that's a super long list. That is something that they have access to. I brought plenty of sheets that has that on there if that's something that you're interested in. So again, you come to campus, you take your four core classes that he talked about, and then you come to Wallace, and we pay for 6 hours. So let's say that you wanted to go into welding. You would come and take those first two welding courses, but you wanted to get ahead. You could take a third, but you're going to have to pay for that. So make sure that you know we will only pay up to 6 hours in any of those that you want to go to. It's offered after your sophomore year. So you could come in your summer of your junior year, you could start the program then. And we would pay for 6 hours all the way through your senior semester. So with that being said, let's say, for instance, you want to go into welding. We're offering to pay for close to 30 hours of your welding degree, which means more than likely when you graduate from high school, you'll have 1 year left in our program. So it really does save a lot of money. But bear with me, it's not something that you hate high school and you want to get out and leave for a day or leave for half a day. That's not what this is about. Because if you make a D, this is in any of ours, if you make a D or lower, you have to sit out a semester. And then that goes on your college transcript that you made a D or an F, because you can't withdraw because you have to go through us. And then that also goes on your high school transcript because you're getting dual credit for both things. So please make sure this is something that interests you, that you're very serious about it, and you want to get into the workforce, you know, because it is a great opportunity. You could be 19 years old with a welding degree starting out at, I want to say they start out at $65,000. So it is very good. It's not for everybody, but it is a very, very good program. Okay. Also, on the academic side of things, so strictly dual enrollment. He talked about AP courses. You can take AP courses, or you can take dual enrollment courses. And what that means is you would come, you have to pay out of pocket. As of right now, each of our 3-hour class is $444 a class. So you would have to pay $444, and you would have to provide the book. You can take that online. I don't think y'all allowed to take them during school, correct? So online or something like that, you have to go through them. They have to approve whatever it is that you want to take before you can take those academic courses. But you can take those, any kind of class that you would like to, as long as it's approved through them. But again, it counts for college credit and high school credit. So you have to know that when you're taking that course, that's going on your college transcript. Okay? One of the biggest that we have here at Coleman High School is the Fast Track Academy. I'm sure many of you have heard about the Fast Track Academy. One of the biggest differences in it is you have to have a 3.0 for our others for regular dual enrollment, and for career tech you have to have a 2.5. But to get into our Fast Track Academy, you have to have a 3.0. And you have to be an incoming junior or senior. What that means is you come to our campus all day long. So you will never come here for a class as a junior or a senior. So you come to us, we set the schedule for Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, you're with us. Fridays, we don't offer many classes. Most of the time, academics don't have class on Fridays. So you're just with us all day. And we set your schedule, and everything that you take in college, you're also getting credit for in high school. So at the end of your senior year, so if you come in as a junior and start with us in the Fast Track Academy as a junior and senior, you graduate with a two-year degree, and you graduate with a high school degree. We do not offer scholarship money to that from our side of things. So dual enrollment does not pay for that. There are many scholarships out there that you can go out and get for your children. I know our Future Foundation scholarships, those are used a lot for dual enrollment students and for the Fast Track Academy. So there is money out there to offer for you. We do provide books for our Fast Track. So you would have to pay that tuition. But again, we do all the scheduling. You come through, and let's say you want to be the band. So you're like, I can't do Fast Track Academy. You can. We will make sure to set your schedule that you're out by 2 o'clock, or if you're on the baseball team or the football team, we will set your schedule to make sure that you're out from Wallace to be able to make it to practice on time. So we do try to provide above and beyond so that you can still be a part of Coleman High School, because we don't want you to lose that sense. But it's a very good program if you want to get ahead, if you want to be a doctor or a lawyer, or you want to go to PT school, to go ahead and get ahead, so because you're going to be in school for a long time. But those are our programs that we offer here. I'm sure we have some questions. Is there anything that I can answer for anybody? Yes, ma'am.
You said that
it would not be excused on the college side of things. They would have to speak to their professors if they were going to have to be in and talk to their coaches and try to see what they could work out. Some professors might be saying, okay, I understand that. All of our professors know who their Fast Track students are, though. We send out a list and they know, because the grading's a little bit different. So, because here it's based on a number scale, there it's based on a letter scale. So we do have to do things a little bit different. So all of our professors know, and it's just an open line of communication between them and the student at that point. Because we try to aid them in, here's your class, and they have a computer lab that they can come do all of their homework on our floor. It's up until 6 p.m. every day. But outside of that, we really try to focus on them, you know, being a college student. They're in classes with college students all the time. We offer an English 101 and 102 and Lit 102 by somebody who teaches in our department along with a history class. But outside of that, they're all with regular college students, so it kind of makes them grow up a little bit.
If you're out of district, do you still pay the out-of-district fee to the high school?
Yeah.
Yeah, still in the middle of our school.
They would take enough to get them by for whatever the high school
wants. Well, my question is, how many classes do we have to pay for?
Probably 16 hours, I would say, at the most.
16 hours.
But most of the time it's between, because 12 hours you have to be a full-time student. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to throw 12 through 16. So it might be 15, something like that. And again, you can calculate, as of right now, it may go up, but as of right now, the average 3-hour course for us is 444.
And you pay all the college.
And we provide the books.
For
Fast Track Academy, we provide the books.
And according to how many classes you take at the four quarters in your 11th and 12th grade year, but whichever elective credits you need, you still have to take those credits to make your high school graduation credits. If you go to the Fast Track Academy, you would be taking the exams.
So every class in Fast Track Academy is on campus.
Okay.
On our campus, on Texas campus. And you have to have a 3.0. When you talk about the ACT, that's one thing I did not mention. I'm sure a lot of you have not taken the ACT, but if you have, we look for an 18 in English and a 20 in math. So if you've made an 18 in English, you automatically test into college English, which is our English 101. And if you make a 20 on your ACT, you automatically test into Math 112, which is college algebra. If you don't make one of those two, you can come to our campus and take the AccuPlacer, which will put you in whatever class you need to get into. Any more questions?
What's the advantage of taking the dual enrollment with the AP courses? What's the advantage versus just taking AP class here at Coleman versus doing the dual enrollment AP classes there? You still have to score well on the test, start to pass the test, get a credit.
So our AP courses that we offer here, as far as a dual enrollment option with those, the advantage is that they would be basically guaranteed that college credit. So let's say you have two students, both taking AP English language and composition their junior year. Okay? They both make B's in the course, but one of them makes a 4 on the AP exam, one of them makes a 2 on the AP exam. Well, that person that made a 2 on the AP exam doesn't earn the college credit. But if they were both enrolled through Ball State in dual enrollment, getting dual enrollment credit, they would automatically earn that credit as a B. Does that make sense? That's why we offered that as an option, because a lot of people have test anxiety. They feel reluctant to take an AP course where that college credit is all based on that one test they take at the end. So we try to implement that as an option so that that wasn't something they worried about as much. But they still get the rigor of AP. They still have an opportunity to take the AP exam, but it gives them a better opportunity or a more reliable opportunity to earn that college credit. Does that make sense? So both options that are on our campus with our AP courses and our dual enrollment, that will be here. The only ones that they would go to Wallace and take would be if they were part of the Fast Track Academy.
Yes, there are a number of dual enrollment classes offered here on campus.
And you can also take, if you want to take an online class through Wallace, Wallace has numerous online courses available. If you wanted to do that, we would set aside time in your schedule so that you could be in our computer lab. You could take an online class without having to go full-blown college. So what we try to do is offer options. We call it sometimes the smorgasbord, you know, because you can kind of pick and choose. If you think your child is ready to go to college full-time and you know for sure that that's what you're going to do, you're ready to spend the money for that, you're ready for them to be on a college campus all the time, then that's where Fast Track comes in. Okay, if you want them to still be on our campus, and we wanted to give the option of having the rigor of the AP course with the option of the on-campus dual enrollments, because you want to earn the college credit and guarantee it, basically. What you're doing if you do dual enrollment through the AP course is pretty much about an insurance policy, because you're guaranteeing that that course will be on their college transcript and their high school transcript. What that gives you is you know where they are every day, and that we're checking attendance, and that if they're not here and they're not in that first period class, you're going to get that email or text message that says, please remember to send your note to Coleman High School. So you know where they are. If they didn't make it to school safely, you're going to get a message and say, my child's supposed to be at school. What happened? So, you know, that's one thing. It's more of a security blanket, I guess, if you're not ready to send them to that college setting full time, but you do want to go ahead and start accumulating that college credit. So that's why we did that. And then if we have courses that you would like to take at Wallace State and they're available online, but you're not ready for them to be at the campus all the time, you can do that online here for the day. We'll just allocate that period. We just need to know that. Does that help answer that a little bit?
I can't remember that you said there is a cost if we do the dual enrollment with Wallace for the AP courses, and then the $444 as well for that.
Yes, sir.
What that's doing is, that fee is not for the AP course. You're in the AP course here for free. Is to make sure that you get the college credit on your transcript at Wallace. So you would be a student at Wallace, a student here, although you're sitting here in our classroom, but it would put it on that college transcript for you.
So those teachers work for us as well as here.
Is the dual enrollment part of it? Do they still, I know, take an AP class, they're not dual enrollment, you still have to take the test?
Yes, you do.
So that would be above the...
You do still have to take the AP exam. That is one of our policies, plus we have to turn those numbers in for our AP course audit. So it's really the only way that we could figure out to have the best of both worlds here. So yes, you do take the AP exam. Any other questions about that?
Virtual school is called Coleman Innovation Academy. It gives our students the ability to have many, many options that a normal student just doesn't have here on campus. We have several students that participate in various activities outside of school that don't allow them to attend as regularly as really necessary to take classes on campus. So, it's really a program that's designed for students who are already thriving in their academics. You know, we've had some students come to us who want to take virtual classes because they're struggling on campus, and that's just not really an option. You know, if they're already behind on credits, or you know, we've already seen that they are at risk of failing any courses, And we're not going to give them that option. So basically the way this works is it's a program called Compass, and they can take all their academic classes, all their core classes, electives, everything that's required to graduate, you can take online. The students could also participate in extracurricular activities here if they prefer to take a fine arts class. We have some students in our theater program who are virtual school students. We have students who are athletes, students who are in the band. So it just gives those students who can't attend school regularly because of other things going on in their life, it gives them the option to still be able to earn their credits in high school and participate in everything here as well. Any questions about that, about virtual school? They would apply online. There's a link on the school system website under the technology tab. Look for Coleman Innovation Academy. Just scroll down and there'll be an application on there for the 2018-2019 school year. Those applications are due on April the 10th. I think somewhere we had a deadline that was a little bit sooner than that, and we decided to extend it because we were a little bit later getting the registration cards out this year. So if your child's interested, have them fill out an application. We review all those, you know, sometime in late April, and, you know, we'll let them know if they get accepted into that program or not.
You may have seen recently where the State Department of Education has released new report cards. They have many different indicators that calculate into that score on the report card. One of the indicators that they calculate for high schools is college and career readiness indicators. By the time a student graduates high school, they are supposed to meet at least one of these college and career readiness indicators. One of those, they have several different options for us. One is AP attainment, which would be a qualifying score on an AP exam, meaning a 3, 4, or a 5 on an AP exam. The other is a career and technical education credential. So if you're in one of those career and technical education programs on our campus or at the Coleman Area Career Center, you would be taking some type of examination where you could credential in that course. An ACT benchmark attainment. What that means is on one subtest of the ACT, the English, the math, the science, and the reading, that you would meet a benchmark score on at least one of those subtests. The other is college credit attainment, which would be a dual enrollment course. So if you did Fast Track Academy or if you did the dual enrollment through AP, even if you didn't pass the exam, or if you did one of the career technical education dual enrollment courses, that would make the college and career readiness indicator there. The work keys attainment, seniors take the work keys assessment before they leave. They take it in the spring of their senior year. Next year we'll be taking it in the fall. And if your student scores what they call silver or gold on that exam, and they do make one of the college and career readiness indicators. And the last one is military enlistment. So any one of these can be coded on your child's IMEL record. And some students will have multiple college and career readiness indicators met by the time they graduate. But these are the options that we have for college and career readiness indicators. So when we're looking at what they're taking, what our guidance counselors will be doing is also making sure that we're going in the direction of meeting one of these. So if we're not on track to meet an ACT benchmark, then we'll be looking for another option, whether it might be one of the dual enrollment credits, whether it would be the work keys, or we may be asking, are you planning to join the military? So we're going to be looking for different things to help your child find their pathway. Okay, on your registration card, we've changed it a little bit. I'll go ahead, Mr. Johnson. If you do, please make sure that you have your cell phone information and your child's cell phone information as well. The reason that we need that on the card is because once you turn in that card in the summer, when our guidance counselors are working on schedules and looking to see what will fit in a schedule and what won't fit into a schedule, they may call you over the summer. Now, here's what happens on that request. You have your four core on the front side. And if you'll notice, on English, you're going to have regular English and either pre-AP or an AP option. On your math, we started a few years ago when students came up from the middle school to the high school. We were noticing there was this huge burden of a decision that parents felt about getting them in the right math class. And it was something that we were trying to work closely with the middle school to make sure that we were getting them in the right class. But then parents felt like they had to make a decision, and it was a life or death decision. I'm sure you've heard all these stories about, oh my gosh, if you get started on the wrong one, you can't get off that track. And so what we started doing a few years ago is we worked with the middle school on current achievement, current math classes that they're in, how they're doing in those courses, standardized test scores. And so we look at a variety of different options and different scores on your child, and then we're placing them in the math class that's appropriate for them in the ninth grade. And the past 2 years, it's been like a dream come true, right? Don't you think? I mean, we were having students start out in that ninth grade, and we were having to change classes, and they would be struggling, and they wouldn't be in the right course. So what we do now is when they come from the middle school, we're placing them in that class, and then based on their achievement here, we're going to continue to work on the correct pathway. Now, our math teachers will work on placing them in those courses, and when they have that completed, you're going to get a letter in the mail that says this is the recommended math class for your student. But they won't do that until, you know, probably closer to the end of the semester. So if they're in math team right now, they're doing well in math team, they're probably going to go ahead and be in that next level of math team course. But it will be based on their grades and their student achievement. But you will get a letter about their math class. And then if you have questions or if you disagree about that, we'll have an option for you to do an override form. If you do fill out an override form on any class, if you want to put your child into a course that is not recommended or does not meet the prerequisite, if they don't meet the prerequisite for that course, and you choose to put them in there outside of our recommendation, we will not change their schedule next year. Changing a schedule is like a nightmare when you're trying to fit in the courses that they have to meet. And it seems like sometimes when you're at home or when your child's coming home to tell you, well, I'm struggling, I just need to get a schedule change. It's just not that easy. If there are 30 students sitting in the course where they think they want to go into, I'm not going to put 31. If they're sitting in a course where there's 24. So sometimes it depends on their required courses that they need for graduation. It's just not that easy. So if you do request an override and we meet that request and put it in their schedule, we will not be able to make schedule changes once we get those schedules in place. And let's see, what else have we got on there? All of your pre-AP, your 11th and 12th grade, in your science, Mr. Johnson spoke earlier about your requirements. We try to get the required science courses. They require that everyone take biology and everyone take a physical science, which could either be physical science or chemistry. Once they have those out of the way in 9th and 10th grade, you have options. And so on the 11th grade card and the 12th grade card, you have some choices in science. And if you'll go, I have emailed you the link to the course selection guide. Did you get that today on your Blackboard Messenger? If you didn't, the link to the course selection guide is on the homepage of the Coleman High School webpage, down at the bottom under announcements. And it's a PDF version of all the courses that we offer with descriptions, prerequisites, requirements. Everything we're going over tonight is in that course catalog. So you can read about those courses and make sure on that science, and science, math, and history, we're going to put them in the math class, but in the science, look for their career of choice. If they're wanting to go into the medical field, you probably want to consider AP biology or AP chemistry. If they're wanting to go into physical therapy, believe it or not, you need to consider AP physics, because you do have to take physics at the college level. So we want to make sure that if they're going to have to take that class at the college level, we would like for them to have some background knowledge here before they go take it there. So that would be something when you're looking at what they want to go into. I would also say, if you're at the junior and senior year and you think you want to go to the University of Alabama Business School, go online to the University of Alabama Business School, whichever major they're wanting to pursue, and look at the classes they're going to have to take. If they're going to have to take Cal 1, Cal 2, and on up, well, then you probably need to try to take that here. So you want to look at what they're going to have to take in college and try to mirror that as much as you can, their junior and senior year here, so that when they go into those classes at a university, if that's where you're headed, that you don't just walk in the door of one of those weed out classes and be the one that is weeded out. Okay? We want to prepare them ahead of time, so we want to make sure that they have the background information that they need. And if you already have your physical education credit, you will not need to select that on the card. If you are on an athletic team or marching band, or you want to join JROTC, you will need to mark that on the card as well. There's an area down at the bottom where you list your post-high school plans. That's going to help us meet those college and career readiness indicators that we had up there on the board a minute ago. So if we're looking for a four-year university, if we're looking for a two-year certification or associate's degree, we need to know that. If you're looking for 2 years and then transfer to a four-year university, we would need that as well. Then on the back, I don't have my glasses. On the back is where you'll need to select your courses. If you're in the going into the 10th grade, you need to make sure that you're selecting courses for art education, foreign language, or career technical education to meet those three required electives that have to be foreign language, fine arts, or career tech. So when you're looking on the back, we said please select in order of preference 1, 2, 3, 4. That does not mean in each column that you pick 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Then you pick 12. We just want you to pick 4. 4. Now, here's why we do that. Let me explain course requests. When these are turned in, we will enter all of this information into our INAR system, and we have the number of students that request each course. Because you request it is not a guarantee that you will get it. We have to have a minimum enrollment before we can offer the course on campus. So if we don't have 12 students take a class, then that class doesn't make. So we would then need, if that was your number one choice and we didn't have 12 students to take the class, we would then go to your number two. Okay, and that's really mostly for electives. Occasionally an AP class will flip-flop. We may have chemistry that'll make 1 year, and the next year physics will make and chemistry won't. So, because sometimes those students will, in the 11th grade, they'll all decide to take chemistry, and in the 12th grade, they'll all decide to take physics. So, sometimes we do have classes that don't make. When your schedule is developed, our guidance counselors, and Mr. Johnson too, he helps put schedules together, it is very difficult to make sure that they're getting all of their graduation requirements and getting their choices. So just know, as we hear this, when you come home with that schedule in the fall, if they say, well, I'm in this art class, and I didn't ask for this art class. Well, it might be because what you asked for didn't make, and it might be because they had to have a certain math and a certain science, and maybe they were in highlight, and maybe they're playing a sport, and so we only had two other class periods in the day to get their electives in. Well, if we only had two classes in the day to get the electives in, we can only choose the two electives that are available during that time. Does that make sense? So occasionally we're trying to meet your number one priorities, which is your core. And then if you are in marching band or athletics, or you make some other special group like chamber choir or jazz band, those are only offered one period. So if you got into those activities, it may limit your options on maybe a couple of other periods. Okay.
So I have a question.
Okay.
You said if you're going to be a sophomore, you pick four. If you're going to be a junior, you pick four. On some of these, it says one credit, half credit, and then some of them, there's no credit. So do I need to pay attention to credit?
if you look at the course selection guide, it will tell you if it's a half credit or whole credit. If it's not listed on there, if it's not listed on there, it may be because it's a program. Like at the Career Center, you go and you're gone all year, and it will take up two periods out of the day. So it's not necessarily going to say on there two credits because you're going into a program. Now, half credits, if you're choosing a half credit course, you would probably need to go ahead and choose two half credits to make the whole. Okay?
I think quite being at the high school, spring that I'm looking at the website.
Well, you would need either a fine art foreign language or career tech, either one. Because they have to have 3 credits. And it can either be from fine arts, foreign language, or career tech, any combination of. It doesn't have to just be down the fine arts category. It could be down the foreign language, it could be down the career tech.
But if they had 2 years of foreign language.
And you already have 2 of them.
You don't have to check that anymore, right?
You don't have to check that anymore. If you've already had 2 years of a foreign language, if you're in the 10th grade and you've had Spanish 1, Spanish 2, and you've had concert band and music appreciation, okay, then you have 3 full credits. So what that means is your junior and senior year, you can take anything on the back that you want to, any of those other electives, as long as you make your prerequisites. Okay?
On that site, sciences on the front, are you able to sign up for more than just one?
You can, depending on what you want to go into. Now, I would not recommend signing up for 2 AP courses in the same year.
I was thinking more like anatomy, physiology, and biology.
You can, yes. And we also, in our career tech program, the Health Science Academy, that gets listed on there, she offers, it's a human body structure and function, that will count as a science class as well. So you can take that, and it could be either a science or career tech. But we do have students that double up sometimes, depending on their career interest. But you can double up. Yes? Okay, on the back of your electives, this is what's most important. You give us 4 things to choose from, at least. Okay, at least. You can put 5 if you want to.
Like Ms. Hoskins, some of them have cheated 1 credit, some of them have cheated 2 1-credits, and then a half. But half's hanging out there, nothing actually.
Right. Okay, if you choose a half, choose another half. But on the back, rank order, at least 4 elective choices. At least. You can go ahead and put 5 and 6 if you want to. Okay. All that does is give us more options where if we couldn't meet 1, 2, and 3 and we get them down and we need to fill them up, we're just going to know what you were interested in. Okay?
So in other words, if they take a
If they take a driver's ed this summer, that's a half credit. Here's the question. And then the health is another half credit. Okay, if we take health next year on campus during the school year, and you don't do that in the summer, you're going to need another half credit elective. You probably want to choose a few of them so that we can pair that health up with something.
A half credit indicates that it's only 1 semester. So that's why we need another half to be that other semester in that same class period. Does that make sense? So it's a full credit, that indicates that it's a class that lasts all year.
A half credit is 1 semester. 1 semester, either the fall or the spring.
Yeah, off campus.
If you do driver's ed off campus and you don't do health off campus, then you're taking health, but you're going to have to take something else opposite that health. And you're going to have to take another class opposite that health. Just pick things you're interested in and we'll put it together.
So the half and half count as one?
The half and half counts as one. Well, if it's a health, it counts as your health. No, it doesn't matter if it's. It could be a half credit of a fine art, and you get a half credit of a fine art. You'll somewhere take another half credit of something. Yes. I know. Pick your, here's the most important thing. Pick your core first. Pick your core first. If you're on an athletic team or marching band, mark that. Okay, that's going to take up 5 credits right there. If you have 4 core and you're either in marching band or athletics, that's 5, gone. You only have 2 more credits. So on the back, give us at least 4 choices. And you can go ahead and put 5 and 6 if you want to. Those are not guarantees. Those are requests. We're going to put the rest of it together. And we'll build a schedule. Believe me, they work tirelessly. I'm not the schedule building pro. I'm the one that walks in and says, can we do this? Can we do this? Can we do this? But they will work tirelessly to build the schedule to make sure that your child's graduation credits are met. That's the number one priority. The other priority is to make sure that they're getting on the college and or career path that they choose as best we can. Okay, those are our priorities. The electives, sometimes they're going to build on their college and career goals. Sometimes they just want to take a cool class on campus. And they do. Sometimes they just want to take dance. And that's great. Because when you're taking 7 periods a day, sometimes you need to move. You know, sometimes you need a mental break. That's great. Sometimes they say, I want to take guitar. You don't play guitar. Well, so I want to take the class. Go pick up a guitar. We have people right now all over town that learn to play guitar in their junior year of high school. We have piano. Learn something new. We have science of Alabama history. That was a new class last year. They take it and they learn a lot. So it gives them something else to do. And if they say that they want to take it, then let them take it. Because they're learning something, I promise you. Okay, let me give you an example here. Dana's marked this one, and she said I could. Okay, on Kaveri's example, they put education teaching is her number one choice, down here on the right-hand corner. Her number 2 choice is Spanish 2. Her number 3 choice is Facts and Foods. Her number 4 choice over here is Psychology, which is a half credit. She's taking Health, and she has that marked on the front. So I guess you're going to take Driver's Ed in the summer? Okay, so that Health and Driver's Ed match up to make a whole. And she's, I'm going to have her go ahead and pick a couple of other options as a 5 and 6 just in case we need them, in case that Psychology doesn't match up with that Health. Okay? Questions?
Let me comment on that. If you have a child that you want them to have 2 years of a foreign language, we do not recommend a gap year. So we're not big fans. If she wants Spanish 2, we want Spanish 2 to be number 1 so we can get her in it. So unless you get priority because she's already at Spanish 1 to get her in Spanish 2, if she got that education, but then that education class was very wonderful, but it knocked out being able to get her in Spanish. And then she's like, oh, I really want to have that second year because the college I'm looking at is highly competitive and wants 2 years of that foreign language. That gap year of not having that foreign language could really hurt her. And so that would be a phone call I'd say, okay, Ms. Adams, is what we're looking at. She's looking at Spanish year and this year, what do we think is going to go? So those are the kinds of conversations, especially when it comes to things that build on each other, like the languages, that we would want to keep her education in mind. But then we want to make sure that we don't make it harder on them than necessary until a year in between what's not home. Is that okay?
somebody back here have a question too?
About Peter, has some things changed, and unless it's changed today, but when I looked at it 2 days ago, some stuff on the card don't match what's online. Like when we took theater this year, it was theater 1/2, and it was a half a credit and a half a credit. But on the card I'm looking at 1, 2, 3, whole.
We get, the state has subject codes, and sometimes the State Department of Education does not get their subject codes and descriptions out at the same time as we get our course catalog out. And so they changed some things this year, and Mr. Johnson is now the guru on that side.
I don't know about guru. I've looked at all of it. We changed, I say we didn't change. The State Department changed all the course codes for fine arts. Last year they went back and did all the sports. So like for years and years and years, if you played a sport, you just had a live PE credit. Well, last year they came in and said, we're going to have football 1, 2, 3, and 4, and baseball 1, 2, 3, and 4, and so on and so forth for all your different sports, which kind of makes sense because we're not supposed to issue credit for the same course code again and again. So that allows us, for a football student, they get 4 years of football credit. Well, now they've gone back and did the same thing for the fine arts. So it did the same thing in band. So it has like marching band, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And theater, 1, 2, 3, and 4. They made them all full credits.
So they're so, a full year now.
Yes.
Of so
theater
is. Piano is a full year.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
So if we had 1/2 this year, and it was a half and a half to make a whole, so when do we mark on a card for the next grade? 3?
3. Yeah, we really, that's a good point. We rely heavily on our instructors for, especially our fine arts. So if they have an art class, I mean, art class is a good example, but a theater class or art that's more advanced, we'll ask them, hey, what about this student? We can place them in this section or that section, you know, so we get feedback from them as well. So, you know, mark what you think is appropriate, and that'll give us an idea of what they're interested in. So if it is theater, you know, if there's something that needs to be tweaked a little bit, we can talk to Mr. Cook and see exactly what he wants, what sections he wants specific students to be in. Does that make sense?
So maybe we can ask him before we want
it. Sure, mm-hmm. Sure. And also, you know, don't stress out about, like,
email him, he'll do it.
Oh, yeah, he will. Don't stress out about keeping up with all the things your child has taken since they enrolled here. You know, we look at all that when we're doing schedules. So we're gonna do everything we can to ensure they get all the credits they need to graduate. We're not gonna let them get to their senior year and not have something they have to have. Does that make sense? So you don't have to keep track of that from year to year. I mean, it's good to know, and we want you to know, but you know, don't think that we're gonna let them get to the end of their senior year and go, well, you didn't graduate because you didn't have that, you know, CTE credit you had to have to graduate. Now that's not gonna happen. Any other questions? Yes.
How did you do the government economics access system?
Okay.
We need to write it on the card or how?
You can write it on the card, and then when it comes time to sign up for summer classes, we usually do that with the last couple weeks.
It'll probably come out in maybe the end of April, because we did have a lot.
The question was about if you want to take a class in the summer, Access for Government online in the summer, or Health online in the summer. Sometimes we have people come in that want to take psychology in the summer, so then move into psychology too, Coach Harmon, or you know, different options. But if you want to take a summer course, if you're going to take your Access in Government, mark it on the card that you want to take that online in the summer, just so we know not to build it in. And then whenever we advertise summer school, you'll need to get a summer school form. It's going to be on my newsletter. If you don't get my newsletter, make sure that your email and cell phone number is in email correctly. It'll also be on our morning announcements. I send those out too if you're not getting that email. Okay, Ms. Bishop Hollis sends that out on Remind 101 also. Okay.
Business and multimedia. You've got business tech application. There's no credit, so I assume that's a.
It is. It's a full credit.
Okay. So those are classes here.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. The But the Coleman Career Center, that's not here.
That's not here. Coleman Career Center is up in Vineland.
These are the only ones that aren't on campus.
That or Wallace State Fast Track, yes.
But all of these, they can take it to be.
That's correct. The career tech classes down the right-hand side, those are all on our campus. The arts education down the left-hand side and the general electives on the bottom are all on our campus. The foreign language are all on our campus. German is accessed online. The middle section where it says Coleman Area Career Center, those are not on our campus. It's a credit. Sometimes you should. And some of these used to be half credits. Some of the art credits, the reason he's asking, why does that say one credit down the arts, and then over on the other side it doesn't? Over on the career tech side, those are full credit courses. Okay, the arts, that's what we were talking about a minute ago. Some of those last year were half credits. Like, she needed to know that because her child took a theater 1-2, those were half credit. Now they've changed it to full credits. But they're full credits. These are the career tech. Okay?
Do you guys, do they have to be able to drive to the career center, or is there a bus that takes them or anything like that?
We have a bus that goes to the career center. They pick the students up right out front of the school, take them up there, bring them right back for lunch. Usually it depends on which block they're in, but we do have a bus that travels to the career center. Any other questions?
The career center, morning block, afternoon block, so they can either take first thing in the morning or late in the afternoon?
They can take mostly a middle block. We have a partnership with Coleman County Board of Education, and so it really works better for our students to go in the middle block, because Coleman County students, it's easier for them to either come in the first block or the last block, so we usually have the option of getting more students in that middle block. But we do. Sometimes we'll have students in the first or the last, depending on what program they're requesting and the availability at the career center. Any other questions? Yes.
Well, and that was another reason we were going to try to do this one.
too, so that if you had questions, that way you could go home and talk about it. You can talk about it tomorrow night. If they didn't come back and ask another, you can. We'll schedule it, but we're going to try to get through those first student meetings. And if that doesn't answer all the questions after your meeting tonight and after their individual meeting, then we will do a follow-up if we need to. Because what we'll do, when they put that period down, if they say the best time for me to make third period, then what we're going to do is take everybody that we can meet with third period, and we're going to go through it. So it's not necessarily going to be like 9 o'clock is your time. It's going to be, we're going to start with that third period group, and we're going to go and get as many in that day as we can. So it may be on Monday, but it may be on Tuesday. But when you turn in your cards, if you do have other questions, they're going to bring those cards into their homeroom teachers on Friday. If you want to attach it, staple it to the back of that card, then when we take them, that way we can go ahead and know ahead of time if they have an appointment that we can answer some of those questions too, or maybe get back to me. Okay? Any more questions?
Do you have a general homeschool schedule outlined?
No. What courses are available or the dates? The dates of summer school, I can't tell you what the dates are, but I can tell you how we do it. The first week that we get out after graduation, we do not have summer school because we're doing transcripts, posting transcripts, mailing out failure letters, we're sending transcripts to colleges. So the first week after graduation, we do not have summer school. It will start usually the next week. Am I right? Starts the second week of summer. Okay, then we'll go for 4 weeks. We do not have summer school the week of the 4th of July. And then we'll have 4 more weeks in the second session. The way summer school works is there's a June session and a July session. And within those sessions, there's a morning and an afternoon. So if you want to take one class, you could come in June during the morning only, and that would be it. If you want to take two classes, you could come in June morning and afternoon and be done with it. Or you could come June and July morning session and just go all summer. We did have some people that do that. Like on AP, let me say this as a disclaimer. If you have a very ambitious student that wants to take all AP classes, all 4 AP classes, my junior year, every single thing I'm going to take, my senior year is going to be all AP, we would advise against that. That is a very, extremely heavy load. Look at what their career interests are and lean towards those AP classes. If you're looking to go to a university in engineering, lean towards your science and math. It's not that they're not all great. They're all great. The teachers are great. The classes are great. But the load is heavy, so I would not recommend taking 4 AP courses. Okay? And if your child is adamant about it, then that will be one of those conversations and meetings that you'll need to have to make those decisions. Okay? And it's not that some students do it, but you and our counselors and assistant principals, we all need to be on the same page if that's going to happen. Okay, any more questions?
I just for other parents who are out there as well, I did notice that there are some colleges that do not look at weighted average. They only look at the unweighted average their acceptance. So beware of that.
And that's why we caution on taking too many, too. Usually if they take a moderate load, then it's manageable. If they come to school and they do their homework, and it's a lot of work. But if they're active in their education, they're usually going to be fine. It is difficult. I'm not saying it's not difficult. It is difficult. The college is too. So that's what we're trying to prepare them for. Okay. Thank you for coming. Let's know if you have individual questions. We have applications up here. If you need any of the information from Wallace State, any of Fast Track or the Career Tech.